making this announcement in compliance with the Open Public Meeting Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, laws of the state of New Jersey. Borough Clerk has prepared a schedule of meetings of the governing body of the Borough of Kenilworth for the year 2019. The Borough Clerk has posted a true copy of the schedule on the bulletin board located at the front entrance of Borough Hall and has mailed true copies of the schedule to the local source of Star Ledger and the Home News Tribune to maintain a copy of the schedule in our office during the year 2019. Accordingly, the notice requirements of the Open Public Meetings Act have been satisfied in regard to this meeting. Please stand for the salute to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, roll call, Madam Clerk.
Councilwoman Cecere.
Here.
Councilman Clemente.
Here.
Councilman David.
Here.
Councilwoman Karlovich.
Here.
Councilman Ladai.
Here.
And Councilman Shelkey.
Here.
Motion to accept the minutes of the regular council meeting of May 8, 2019.
Motion made.
Second.
Motion made by Councilman Cecere, seconded by Councilwoman Clark. All in favor?
Aye.
Various advisories were received from the New Jersey State League of Municipalities. A notification was received for the New Jersey Department of Transportation 2020 state aid grants. Notice from Union County regarding pre-construction meeting for roadway paving. The VFW invited the mayor and council to the Memorial Day services. An award request was submitted from St. Teresa's for the eighth grade graduation. A resident submitted a letter concerning property grading and runoff, and an invitation to a grand opening of PM pool service was received.
Motion to accept the communications and reports.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Councilman Clemente, seconded by Councilwoman Crawford. All in favor?
Aye.
A couple of reminders, the Union County Board of Elections is rolling out their new voting machines. I'm sure you've heard this before from me. Kenilworth will be using these new machines for the June primary. There's some demonstrations left on these machines that will be held at the Union County Courthouse in Elizabeth on Tuesdays from 11 to 3, and at the Colleen Fraser Building in Westfield on Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 1, for those interested. Memorial Day services are Monday, May 27th at 11 a.m. at the VFW Hall on 33 South 21st Street. And also I wanted to wish a happy birthday to Michelle Cross George. It's her 90th birthday. And if anybody knows something about Kenilworth history, Michelle Crosses have our long old name. We did send a proclamation to the family. And we named Irma Shaw Cross George Day today. I'm going to read it real quick. It's not that long. Whereas Irma Shaw Cross George will be honored by friends and relatives on the occasion of her 90th birthday on May 22, 2018. And whereas the Shaw Cross family left Pennsylvania in 1898 and acquired the old Sayre estate on Springfield Road and what was then known as New Orange. Whereas the Shaw Cross family was involved in Kenilworth's movement to become an independent community in 1907. Irma's grandfather, Sanderson Sandy Ruth, was very outspoken in his effort and was elected as the borough's first tax collector. And whereas the experience gained by working in the transportation business for Railway Valley Railroad led them to establish Shaw Cross Express Company. And whereas the Shaw Cross family was known for its philanthropy and the community for being a major financial benefactor in the erecting of the 1914-15 of the Old Methodist Church, donating the 1900 Park in the 1920s, donating frequently to local clubs and organizations, sponsoring the Shaw Cross Express Little League team for many years, and making donations of food at Christmas time to needy local families. And now that, therefore, by the virtue and power authority vested in me as Mayor of Kenilworth, on behalf of the Kenilworth Borough Council and all citizens hereof, I am due by here proclaim May 22nd, Irma Shaw Cross George Day. So happy birthday to Shaw Cross and long life to her. Okay. Finance report, Councilwoman Carlos.
Thank you, Mayor. Tonight, the borough will be introducing an ordinance to authorize the financing of various public improvements. The improvements are part of the 2019 capital budget plan previously adopted with our budget. Second reading and public hearing will be June 12th at 8 p.m. Delinquent tax notices have been mailed. If you receive a notice and have a question, please feel free to call the Tax and Finance Office at 908-276-5800. Thank you.
Thank you. Public Works, Councilman David.
Thank you, Mayor. A couple of things. Saturday, June 1st, the DPW yard will be open from 8 to 12. They will accept electronic waste, motor oil, and single-stream recycling. Since May 27th is Memorial Day, it's a holiday. There will be no collecting of curbside recycling that date. All residents are to put it out on Thursday, May 30th. So put your recyclables out on Wednesday night, May 29th, for May 30th pickup. And the only other thing I got is we had the street fair on Sunday. DPW was out there, set up all the barricades, tables, chairs, trash receptacles. They cleaned the street afterwards, did a great job. And that's it.
Okay. Thank you. Public safety, Councilman Committee.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm in receipt of the April 2019 Municipal Court Report, and also have the Chief Zimmerman's 2019 report for May. On May 16th, Chief Zimmerman attended the annual Kenilworth Fire Department's memorial service held at the Fire Department headquarters. On May 21st, David Braley High School juniors and seniors took part in an anti-drinking and driving program that was sponsored by the Kenilworth Municipal Alliance and the Pennsylvania DUI Association. The simulator had the ability to not only induce intoxication into the users driving, but into the cars that are driving around you. It forces you to not only worry about how you are driving on the road, but also about other motorists. Kenilworth School Resource Officer Brian Picton facilitated the program. From June 10th to June 14th, a refresher training is scheduled for EVOC, which means Emergency Vehicle Operator course, at the Police Academy in Scotch Plains. Officers will receive refresher training on special driving skills required to operate a vehicle under very demanding police patrol conditions. And finally, the Kenilworth Police Department is asking residents to remain vigilant in deterring thefts from unlocked cars parked within the borough during the late evening through early morning hours by making sure that their vehicles are locked and secured while parked in their driveways and on the street. Please report any suspicious activity to the department immediately if observed. And that's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilman. Planning and zoning, Councilman Shelton.
Thank you, Mayor. I know we have a busy agenda, so I'll be brief tonight. The Planning Board met on May 9th and received two requests from Mayor and Council. Their response will be received prior to our next meeting. Tonight, there are two zoning ordinances for final reading. First, setting path requirements for the basement constructions in regards to the water table to hopefully stop somebody's sump pumps from running continually. And the second one, requiring a construction fence around any sort of construction that requires excavation, so nobody can go on there and hurt themselves. Thank you.
Thank you. Recreation and Fire, Councilwoman Cecilia.
Thank you, Mayor. Two announcements. One for REC, which is the camp registration for the summer is open through Community Pass. And the Fire Department, I attended their May 16th memorial service, and it was very humbling and meaningful. It was a good service to take part in. And that's all I have, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. Health, Education, and Human Services, Councilman Gowdy.
Thank you, Mayor. The Health Department is preparing for the health fair, and that'll be the third week, the third Saturday in September. We're looking for more avenues to serve the public, you know, maybe speaking to Overlook and see if they have some of their trucks out there, like mammogram trucks, you know, and different screening trucks that may come to the health fair here. We're going to do virus shots on that Saturday, and flu shots, and whatever else we deem necessary that we can get our hands on. Right now, we've secured the virus shots, and hoping that works out. Also, the health department really worked tight with the parks department and our city, getting all the vans and vehicles and food trucks, make sure they were safe, make sure they were all permitted, and make sure they all, you know, had their license. So the health department did a great job on that and securing new vendors to appear. And Mayor, I don't know who won the car trophy.
The mayor's trophy went to that Bugatti. That was it was in original condition, beautiful. It was basically a barn find over in Europe, and they brought it over here. So everything there was original.
Wow, that's
not redone. Original paint, original tires, everything. So it was a beautiful, and it still ran.
And that's something that, you know, we're providing at the street fair. but I think it is excellent. And Mayor, thank you, and for the council for sponsoring the street fair. That's
thank
all
you.
I have.
Thank you, Council.
There's one more thing I'd like to add.
Sure.
Restaurant Week is June 3rd through the 7th, and there'll be live music and family activities along the boardwalk. Along the boulevard. During the whole week, everyone come out for Restaurant Week.
Great. Thank you, Lisa.
Resolutions 1 through 8 are listed on the consent agenda and will be enacted by one motion. All items will be reported individually in full in the minutes. The consent agenda was introduced by Councilwoman Cesari and seconded by Councilman Shulkey. Councilwoman Cesari?
Yes.
Councilman Clementi?
Yes.
Councilman David?
Yes.
Councilwoman Karlovich?
Yes.
Councilman Ladati?
Yes.
And Councilman Shulkey?
Yes.
I also have three ordinances this evening. The first one up is 2019-03 for public hearing and adoption.
Okay, the purpose of this ordinance is to amend Chapter 120 of the Land Use Ordinance, whereby the Borough Council seeks the ordinance to establish elevation levels for flood prevention above the seasonal high water table for lowest floors of new buildings, i.e. basements, and establish fencing and other safety precautions at construction sites. At this time, I'll need a motion to open the floor to the public for discussion on this ordinance and this ordinance only.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Councilman Dowdy, seconded by Councilman Cesari. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, anybody having anything to say on this ordinance and this ordinance only, please come forward and state your name and address. Okay, seeing no one, I'll need a motion to close the meeting for public discussion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Councilman Dowdy, seconded by Councilwoman Karlovich. All in favor?
Aye.
Resolution number 9 was introduced by Councilman Shulkey, seconded by Councilman David. Be it hereby resolved that the ordinance number 2019-03, entitled An Ordinance of the Borough of Kenilworth Amending the Existing Chapter 120 Land Use Part 3 Zoning, Article 22 General Regulations, Exceptions and Modifications, adding Item 16, Building Requirements, and Item 17, Securing the Construction Renovation Site within the Borough of Kenilworth, County of Union, State of New Jersey, was introduced and approved on first reading at the regular meeting of the Borough Council on April 24, 2019, and approved for final passage at the regular meeting of the Borough Council of May 22, 2019. After all persons interested were given an opportunity to be heard concerning said ordinance. Be it further resolved that the Borough Clerk is hereby authorized and directed to publish said ordinance in accordance with law. Councilman Cesari?
Yes.
Councilman Clementi?
Yes.
Councilman David?
Yes.
Councilwoman Karlovich?
Yes.
Councilman Ladati?
Yes.
And Councilman Shulkey?
Yes.
The next ordinance I have up is for introduction, 2019-05, an ordinance amending ordinance number 2017-02, providing for compensation for borough employees of the Borough of Kenilworth.
Okay, the purpose of this ordinance is to designate officers' job titles and authorize the compensation range to pay borough personnel.
Resolution number 10 was introduced by Councilwoman Karlovich, seconded by Councilman Clementi. Be it hereby resolved that ordinance 2019-05, entitled An Ordinance Amending Ordinance Number 2017-02, providing for compensation for borough employees of the Borough of Kenilworth, heretofore introduced, is now passed on first reading, and that said ordinance be further considered for final passage at a meeting to be held on June 12, 2019 at 8 p.m. or as soon as thereafter the matter can be reached. At the regular meeting place of the Borough Council, and at such time and place, all persons interested be given an opportunity to be heard concerning said ordinance, and that the Borough Clerk is hereby authorized and directed to publish said ordinance in accordance with law. Councilman Cesari?
Yes.
Councilman Clementi?
Yes.
Councilman David?
Yes.
Councilwoman Karlovich?
Yes.
Councilman Ladati?
Yes.
And Councilman Shulkey?
Yes.
The last ordinance I have is for introduction, 2019-06.
2019-06 is the purpose of this ordinance is to provide financing for the capital budget plan.
Be it hereby resolved that the ordinance number 2019-06, entitled Bond Ordinance to Authorize the Making of Various Public Improvements and the Acquisition of New Additional or Replacement Equipment and Machinery, New Communication and Signal Systems Equipment, New Information Technology Equipment, and a New Fire Engine Partial Funded, and New Automotive Vehicles, including Original Apparatus and Equipment, in, by, and for the Borough of Kenilworth and County of Union, State of New Jersey, to appropriate the sum of $1,525,000 to pay the cost thereof, to appropriate a state grant to make a down payment, to authorize the issuance of bonds to finance such appropriation, and to provide for the issuance of bond anticipation notes in anticipation of such bonds. heretofore introduced is now passed on first reading, and that said ordinance be further considered for final passage at a meeting to be held on June 12, 2019 at 8 p.m. or as soon as thereafter the matter can be reached at the regular meeting place of the Borough Council, and that at such time and place all persons interested be given an opportunity to be heard concerning said ordinance, and that the Borough Clerk is hereby authorized and directed to publish said ordinance in accordance with law. Councilman Cesari?
Yes.
Councilman Clementi?
Yes.
Councilman David?
Yes.
Councilwoman Karlovich?
Yes.
Councilman Ladotti?
Yes.
Councilman Shelby?
Yes.
That's all I have this evening, sir.
Okay. I have a proclamation. I would like, as you know, it is Memorial Day, and as we do, we honor our fallen. And I believe when I read that proclamation in the last we are doing today, we are doing the 75th anniversary of D-Day, which is on June 6th. That's right, we did the Battle of Connecticut Farms. Okay, and I would like to read this. I'm going to ask representatives of the VFW and the Legion please come forward. Ago on June 6, 1944, the largest armada of land, sea, and air forces ever assembled embarked on a great crusade across the English Channel to free the European continent of tyranny that had taken hold of threatened to strangle the very freedom of the cherished most. Over 5,000 ships and 10,000 aircraft carried more than 130,000 soldiers, sailors, and airmen from the United States, Great Britain, Canada, Poland, France, Norway, the Netherlands, Czechoslovakia, New Zealand, Australia, Luxembourg, and Belgium to destroy the Germans. More than 9,000 Americans were returned. On D-Day, American, British, and Canadian forces advanced to the thickest of barbed wire and steel in every respective place. The acts of the Allies on these armies and armies that morning year were far more than heroic. They were the defining moment of the whole generation that changed the course of world history. Thousands gave their last full measure of devotion, and by the end of the day, the peace and freedom that the Nazi occupation had denied to millions of people. Sword. The ideology fueled by hatred was dealt a significant blow on D-Day. A foothold was secured in France, opening the path to Berlin, and liberating the continent from the grip of tyranny. It made possible the achievements that followed the end of World War II, the Marshall Plan, the NATO alliance, and the shared prosperity and security that flowed from the beach. Those who landed on the beaches of Normandy, not only on D-Day, but also throughout the rest of the war, were responsible for the liberation of many of the concentration camps as well as cities, towns, and villages throughout Europe and had suffered for so many years. Thus, 1944 was a year of triumphs as well as sorrows. The Allies made great advances in bringing liberty to millions, while families and friends on the home front faced with knowledge that many of their loved ones would never return, continued to build the arsenal of democracy. It is to those millions of Americans, men and women, veterans and civilians, those who came home from the war, and those who made the ultimate sacrifice that we say a grateful nation remembers. Today, 75 years later, as we carry on the struggle for liberty and universal human rights, let us draw strength from the moment when free nations beat back the forces of oppression and gave new hope to the world. And therefore, I am delude on behalf of the governing body of the Borough of Kenilworth, by virtue of the authority that's in me, I do hereby proclaim June 6, 2019 as D-Day National Remembrance Day. I call upon all citizens to pay tribute to the valued service members who paid the high price to ensure the freedom of the men, the patriots who, through their courage and sacrifice, changed the course of an entire century, to observe this day with programs, ceremonies, and activities that honor those who fought and died so the men and women that had never met might know what it is to be great. And as always, on Memorial Day, when you're enjoying your day off and having your hot dog and hamburger, just remember what the day's for. It's not for damn sales or anything like that. It's to remember those who fell in battle and give you that day so you could enjoy it. Okay, at this time, on the motion, open the floor to the public for discussion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Councilman Lake, seconded by Councilwoman Karlovich. All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody having anything to say for the good and welfare of Kenilworth, please come forward and state your name and address.
Mary Mickett, 725 Monmouth Avenue. I know you all miss me.
Yes.
First of all, I want to thank everyone because I haven't been here after Christmas. Between the borough helping for Thanksgiving and Christmas gifts, 1,000 gifts went out to different places. Servicemen, Sister Jacinta, kids in town, you name it, we gave it to them. Battered women, we did them all. And we do it through St. Teresa's Social Concerns of Kenilworth. We also want to thank the mailmen. They just delivered food. They delivered us 25 boxes of food today for our pantry, which they had collected. So we have a very, very wonderful town. We have a lot to be thankful for. We are thankful for you, Mayor, and your council, and for all the people that work. So I want to just thank you all very much. The only thing I do have to ask, I know it's not our property, the road coming off the parkway, but the holes there are really bad. If there's any way we can push the county.
The parkway?
Yeah.
Parkway North, Parkway South?
Parkway, yeah, coming off south.
South.
Yeah, south. Yeah. Because when I'm coming from the gym, I only get on in Union, I get off right there. There are a couple, they're really bad. And naturally, if there's a car in front of you, you don't see it till you really hit it. So if it's possible to push the county, I know what happens over there. They say it's the parkways, it's the county road, it's the parkway road, it's the county road, but it's still holes in the road.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else have anything to add for better for the county?
Hello.
Anthony Capari, 103 South 25th Street, come.
I just brought something Mrs. Mikic just brought up about the potholes. Springfield Avenue, when you pull them off 22, I just noticed that the other day. I was like, this is insane. It was really need to be tapped.
Like the surface of the moon.
Yeah.
I believe that's Union.
Because I was thinking the same thing, but I just wanted to
talk. We've had calls with them.
Apparently we're forgotten territory, because if it's coming to Kenilworth, I guess outside.
Yeah.
Area, maybe we'll pave it and send them the bill. What do you think?
Yeah, that'd be nicer.
Shopping
cameras, whatever. It's really beyond.
You heard that. All Union's watching.
It's
really
for you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Every broken tire in shop, we're going to send them a bill, too, if they don't want to pave it.
But they're aware of it. They are aware of it.
Desperate times call for desperate measures. Anybody else having anything to add for the benefit of Kenilworth? Okay, seeing no one, I'll need a motion to close the meeting for public discussion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Councilman Dowdy, seconded by Councilwoman Cicero. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, at this time, the Borough Council, as the local ABC Board, will convene the hearing for the alcohol beverage control licenses with special conditions on their licenses. Special conditions may be imposed on a license by the municipal issuing authority as deemed necessary and proper to accomplish the objects of New Jersey Statutes Title 33, Intoxicating Liquors. Borough Attorney Capiz, please join the ABC Board on the dais.
Sit here.
Where are you going, Borough Clerk?
Switching seats.
Your signature.
Playing attorney.
She couldn't do the job better. All right, attorney?
Mayor, I need your indulgence. We are taping this. Law enforcement has requested copies of this tape, and the clerk has made sure that that happens. I want to read a statement into the record. All retail licenses must be renewed annually, effective July 1st. The Borough of Kenilworth is able to set the time for this event, which is this evening. Upon filing the application, including the requisite license renewal fee, if no objection to the renewal is raised, the governing body sitting as the ABC board may approve the renewal. Tonight, in two specific cases, the governing body will present any concerns they will have with the individual renewal, B, permit the response of the licensee, C, permit residents to provide any relevant information regarding the renewal process. To that end, Mayor, with your indulgence, I would ask of the clerk regarding the conditions on Blackstone. Have you been able to confirm Blackthorn. Are you able to confirm that Blackthorn has agreed to the conditions of the license?
Yes, I spoke with the general manager, Mark Hartnett, and they were not going to contest the special conditions that was
there. Okay. Number two, that leads us to this Gavelstone. Let me just make a couple of points. I've had the opportunity to speak to the council for Gavelstone and actually for the owner of Gavelstone on Friday evening. It was my intention, and it remains my intention, there are no surprises. This is not a trial. What this evening is you, as a governing body sitting as the ABC board, will consider and listen to the material that's provided, and on that basis, make determinations as to what you want to do regarding the license renewal. As it relates to Gavelstone, I would ask the counsel for Gavelstone, who I believe is present, please come forward and, sir, on the record, identify who you are.
Good evening. My name is Bernard Henry, and I'm here on the Gavelstone.
Mr. Henry, we're going to ask some questions.
Yes.
I have enough trouble as an attorney taking care of myself, so I'm not going to tell you how to run your event. What we would like to do is, I have a number of questions.
Yes.
I think you know what they are because we've already telegraphed them to you. And you were a gentleman on the phone, and I must say I had a conversation with your owner on Friday night. I don't normally do conversations on a Friday night at 5:30, but I know this was important to you, and I know the clerk has, we've tried to provide everything we can. Certainly the residents will get their opportunity as well this evening. So that being said, my first question is, has your client renewed by filing the licensing fee?
She paid a fee this morning, I believe.
That's fine, and I will take that on the record. Number two, for my personal curiosity, does your tavern utilize a police scanner?
Scanner?
Police scanner in the tavern.
In terms of what? Scanning the
police?
You
might want to have your owner come up with you. That's certainly up to you.
When you say police scanner, because to me that's a specific term.
There's
a whether or not you're listening in to hear police transmission.
Correct, you got it.
I was out there twice. They don't need to use a scanner because police pass by, I believe, every 20 to 30 minutes. That's the normal.
Well, I doubt that, but I certainly take your representation that you do not. Not that there's anything illegal with doing it. That was just personal peek by me. I was
and
curious.
Also, as you mentioned, you're aware, there are a number of law enforcement that visit that tavern. On any given night, you could have anywhere between 10 and 20% of the people being there are law enforcement, sheriff officers, people from the police department, correction officers. So they may have walkie-talkies. That I can't vouch for.
Okay. You've more than answered the question. I appreciate that. So regarding the conditions, are you familiar with the conditions in the license?
Yes.
That currently exist?
Yes.
And I would ask you on behalf of your client, are you representing this evening that those conditions have been conformed to?
They're being conformed to, but as I discussed with them, we're seeking to improve them. One of the issues, I went over to CAD, as you discussed with me, and what I said to them, they needed to soundproof the place. So what they went out and did is they got an estimate. The least one is going to be approximately $9,800 just to change the awning,
wow,
have it different door because I believe some of the complaints was the sort of entrance towards Fairfield, so we're going to try and get that correct to get it soundproof. That way, when you're coming out, you go through one door, the outer door is closed. That way, by the time you open the outer door, no one outside is here. In addition to that, what we're trying to do, because I believe one of the issues was the complaints about you want to make sure that you're making sure that the garbage is picked up. I said, what I said to her is the best way of proving that you're doing it, what we're going to do is install additional cameras. So the additional cameras will be placed to the other side of Fairfield. That way you can see that they're patrolling and that they're picking up garbage. In addition, what she's done is we now have a log for the patrols where they go outside, they have a decibel reader, where they're reading, they're documenting the levels. You're trying to make sure that it's not disturbing the neighborhood. Because as I understand it, the problem is the street right next to the tavern. And one of the issues that I spoke with Ms. Quintano about was she's not in control of parking. She put up a sign, but you can't prohibit people from parking there. What I asked her was, is there anywhere else in the town where we could have a parking lot where you could use a valet service? Unfortunately, it's a convenience store down the street, and you would have to get permission. And she said she spoke to the council, I believe, last year about trying to get a permit. And one of the issues was, like, you would have to amend ordinances and stuff, and that may not work. The final thing that I suggested, which she doesn't agree with, I suggested, maybe we could pay for a police detail.
Well, you're not a licensee, but you jumped ahead of me, and I let you go because I want to be polite as I can.
Yes.
But my specific questions to you are, sir, regarding the resolution that was adopted last October, specifically number one, is it your representation on behalf of your client that all music has ceased by 12:30 a.m.? And you can certainly confirm with your client. I don't think you're there every night. So what I would ask is, are you saying on the record that all music has ceased by 12:30 a.m.?
It's my understanding from reviewing the CAS that it has.
That's a simple yes or no.
I'm just representing what I saw in the CAS that was presented to me.
But you are not the licensee. So what I'm asking you to do is making representations on behalf of the licensee. Specifically, is it your representation tonight as a licensee that all music has been ceasing at 12:30 a.m.?
Based on what I've been told, yes.
Number two, regarding security, is it your representation, sir, that security personnel are being employed from 10 p.m. to 2200 military time to closing every day of operation to ensure that there shall not be any unreasonable interference with the quiet and peaceful enjoyment of the neighborhood?
Sorry, I don't mean to quibble, but you said from 10 p.m. to 2200, that's the same time. So are you saying
to closing.
Okay. Yes, they have two security guards.
So they are there, and it's their job to make sure that there's no unreasonable interference with quiet and peaceful enjoyment in the neighborhood.
What they're doing is, as all security, they're trying their best to get the people safely out of the bar and away. That's why we're suggesting.
Well, that may be all well and good, but my specific question, sir, are they living up to the conditions that they agreed to in October of 2018? I had an algebra teacher, when I said I wanted an A for effort, she said, no, you get an E for effort. So what I'm specifically asking, sir, is are they living up to the condition that they agreed to, specifically 10 to closing every night, no unreasonable interference?
Based on what you're saying?
But no, not what I'm saying, it's what they agreed to.
Based on what you're saying, no system is perfect. So have people slip through? Yes. They are doing, they're giving their best efforts to make sure everyone leaves in the order. I'm not going to come before the council and lie and say it's been 100% perfect. That would be a lie. That would be disingenuous and disrespectful to the members of this body. So, yes.
However, this governing body made these conditions, and I think much to the disappointment of the residents. And so what I need you to do, I certainly don't want you to lie, but I don't speak for this governing body except to say I will give you a hint. I think they are very interested in knowing that the conditions you agreed to last October are being conformed to. That's, and if you're telling me no, then maybe you get an E for effort, not the A for effort. But I need to know, sir, are you conforming to the requirements of that condition? Is your client?
Well, I understand you asking if there's 100% compliance.
I never use 100% in any of my information.
Well, they're compliant then. If it's not 100%, they're in compliance.
Now, my third question is, sir, are they agreeing to the policing of the neighborhood properties? Each morning after operation, the licensee will conduct an inspection of the neighborhood for garbage, debris, and removal of same. Have they been doing that?
They've been doing it, and that's why we made it. They've been doing that, and that's why I made a suggestion when I started that we're going to put additional cameras in. That way you will have video evidence.
I didn't bet on the Kentucky Derby, but I think it's a good bet here that there's going to be conditions. But what I'm specifically trying to do for the benefit of this governing body is to find out when we met last October, and there were a lot of residents who came out. Are they conforming to those conditions? And I think what you're saying to me is pretty much so. And
yes.
If I'm putting words in your mouth, please correct me. I'm often wrong.
They're doing that. In addition, I believe they contacted the township because they wanted, there was an issue with garbage cans, and they were willing, I believe the cost is about $1,000 because there's no garbage cans on that side of the street, their side or across the street. And she was willing, even though she doesn't have to.
I don't know who she is. Sir, who is
Quintana.
She? And is Ms. Quintana a licensee?
Yes, to put garbage cans there because the township doesn't have any there.
Sir, I now have to get to, and I tried to be as candid with you as I can. These are technical issues that I believe this governing body, sitting as a licensing agency, will be considering as to if they're going to renew the license and what conditions they're going to set. That being said, I now have to ask you my opinion, which matters the least, a very difficult question. As you know, and we provided it with you, the Union County Prosecutor's Office has provided us with a probable cause regarding an Ivan Collins. Now, I'm not sure what the status of that case is. That's not for me to know, but I am troubled, and I'm going to read this into the record, and I'm going to read as slowly as I can. This, what I'm going to read to you is what the prosecutor has provided us. And specifically what the prosecutor said in pertinent part was, during the time Ivan Collins was at Galveston, he consumed several alcoholic beverage several alcoholic beverages. Statements were taken from employees at Galveston in which they stated that Ivan was under the influence of alcohol. I'm going to ask you as candidly as I can, but this is an important issue for this governing body. Do you want to respond to the fact that this man left that place in an alcoholic condition? He was inebriated. He had taken too much liquor. If you know.
Because I practice criminal law, you're asking me whether or not he was drunk. And I don't think from reviewing that probable cause determination that they even said he was drunk. They said, well, the witnesses have said he had a number of drinks. So I don't want to quibble. I don't know his levels. Did he have a couple of drinks? Yes, he did. Did he leave there? Yes, he did. I also reviewed it. What I'm unsure is if they're sure that he was driving, because I believe part of the testimony or what the witnesses have told the Union County Prosecutor's Office is he left with a female. I don't have the benefit of that female statement. I don't know if she was driving. I don't know. All I know is the man was charged. He left the bar. The Union County Prosecutor's Office has spoken with everyone in the bar. They've turned over all the videotapes, and they are cooperating 100%. They will do whatever Union County Prosecutor's Office needs them to do to testify about that situation. But as to whether or not he was drunk, I can't tell you that. I don't believe the prosecutor can tell you that either. What they'll say is we suspect he may have been drunk. But for me to come here and say yes, in answer to your question, if he left there drunk, that would be a lie. And that's something the prosecutor never, they said, based on the statements.
Sure, if you have the documents I provided you, and I'm not representing the Union County Prosecutor's Office, I'm representing this august body. But what they did, they charged this guy with serious crimes, and I would point out to you, as the newspapers show, an individual was killed. An individual was run over.
I understand what you're saying, sir, But from doing that, I know part of the problem caused documents is they would have provided audio, video, and other statements. I have not been able to review that. What I reviewed, I believe, is one page of several different documents. Yes, someone has died. Yes, it's a tragic situation. But ultimately, that has to be played out in the court system. What we have there now is we're trying to make sure that everybody leaves there the right way, that nobody gets into an accident. So, as part of being proactive in anticipation of this hearing, we're even suggesting now having patrons use a Uber service. That way, you use a Uber service to protect people who leave your tavern. That way, you limit your liability and you limit accidents. I understand you're not satisfied with it, but the only thing you can do is be proactive going forward.
Well, let me suggest it to you, sir. And again, I didn't bet on the Kentucky Derby, and I don't bet on what this governing body and their wisdom is going to do. But the fact of the matter is, would you concede that based upon this probable cause determination, this governing body, sitting as a licensing board, could suspend the license until such time as this criminal matter is resolved? I'm not suggesting they're going to do that, but you need to understand that this governing body takes very seriously the statement of the prosecutor that this individual was served an excessive amount of alcohol. And what I'm asking you specifically is, absent a satisfactory answer to this governing body, not to Frank, absent a satisfactory answer, this governing body could take severe action against your licensee if they choose to.
I understand.
Okay.
And now what you're asking me to do is turn to a defense attorney. And one of the issues with the case that the prosecutor's office is having is that, unfortunately, the lady that was killed left a bar drunk. She was served excessive amount of liquor, and she ran out into the street. So it's two wrongs, don't make a right. I'm not saying that. But what we're going to do is protect the patrons of the bar going forward.
So
we're going to provide the service.
So I'm cautioning you. Prospective is something we're going to get to. But I want to read to you from a statement of March 20th, 2019 from the Union County Prosecutor. The investigation later revealed that Collins had been drinking heavily while celebrating his birthday at a Kenilworth bar before driving to Linden that night, Rupert said. It was later estimated that he was driving slightly more than 40 miles in the 25-mile zone when the incident occurred. There's nothing that I have here that I can provide to this governing body from the prosecutor's office that indicates a woman was driving the car, my neighbor was driving the car. What they're saying is that a patron at your tavern, of your client's tavern, was driving the bar, and what I'm was driving from the bar. And what I'm asking you respectfully, because this is not a trial, but what I'm asking you respectfully is, this governing body is considering this very seriously. How would you respond to that question that the prosecutor is saying he was driving the car? The prosecutor is saying he killed that girl.
But this is a document that says 8 of 10 pages. You're reading page 8 of 10. You're not reading any of the statements that they made. You're reading what was put in here. The statements would have been provided to the defense attorney during the probable cause hearing. You're not reading the statements where it said he left with a number of people. You're not reading the statements where they said at this point they're really not able to determine who was driving because the car was tinted. You're not reading those. So
why don't you, because I'm often negligent, why don't you put on the record here for this governing body any statements you want to make that would tend to mitigate the assertions that were made by the prosecutor? In simple language, give me your side of the story for this governing body. I have reports from the prosecutor that said he got drunk, he was speeding, he killed somebody. Now, if you have evidence or something that you want to put on the record, sir, that says, no, Frank, that's not true, please do so for this governing body.
I'm sorry, I'm not his defense attorney. What you're asking me to do, I have access to e-courts, but because I'm not an attorney on the case, I can't go in and get a documentation. So now what you're asking me to do is essentially, what you're asking me to do is go and get the statements from the prosecutor's office and come before you and present it. And you, I cannot do that. You know this is a case that's under active investigation. It's under investigation to the point where they told the employees of the tavern not to discuss it with you.
Can I stop you right there respectfully? You made that assertion. I checked with John Esmerada in the Union County Prosecutor's Office, who specifically refutes that statement. Now, I know Mr. Esmerada. We've had cases. And what Mr. Esmerada tells me is no, there was no, my word, not his word, there was no gag order. There was nothing put on your client that if your client wants, and this is certainly their right, this is an administrative hearing, the standard of proof is significantly less than a criminal trial. I don't know what's going to happen at the criminal trial, but what I'm respectfully asking you, sir, is tell this governing body, when I read from the prosecutor's office what they're telling me, give me something that they should consider as far as a mitigating circumstance.
Just give me 1 minute. Let me get a name of a prosecutor there to speak. I believe they spoke with a detective, but the detective was the one that instructed them, not the prosecutor.
Would you? And I believe that. But here's my point. If somebody's going to testify, Ms. Laura will swear them in.
Hi. Good evening. My name is Mary Ann Matthews.
Where do you work?
Galveston, Warren Grove.
And did you speak with the prosecutor's office about this incident that we're dealing with right now?
Yes, I did.
Who from the prosecutor's office did you speak to?
Detective Lamar Hartsfield and Johnny Cho, I believe that was the other detective.
Did you speak with the attorney that he spoke about?
No. He's not the attorney or the prosecutor on the case.
Who was the prosecutor on the case?
Detective Lamar Hartsfield.
No, the prosecutor.
Johnny Cho, I think that's his name. Can't remember.
And what kind of discussions or statements did you give to him?
He asked us several questions individually. I believe I was the third person that was brought in. He specifically said to us, do not discuss this amongst anyone else because this is an active investigation.
That being said, and I certainly believe you, I'm not at all questioning your veracity at all. Mm-hmm. But what I'm asking you, and I'll only do it this last time because we're kind of going around in circles, for this governing body sitting as a licensing agency, sir, is there anything you want to give them in regard to the allegations from the prosecutor that you consider to be mitigating circumstances?
This is what I'm going to ask you. Even though the prosecutor's office and the detective have said you don't have to discuss it, let me go through the questions.
Okay.
Were you there that night?
Yes, I was.
Was it in fact your birthday then?
Yes, it was.
And were you there with a number of people?
Yes.
Did you see the gentleman in question that night?
Yes.
And when he left the bar, did he leave alone or was he with other people?
He left with other people.
How many other people?
There were about 4 people with him.
Do you know if he drove or if someone else was driving?
To under our knowledge, someone else drove that vehicle that night.
When was the last time that you saw him when he left the bar?
At 1:45 a.m.
Did you see him after he left the door of the bar?
No, we did not.
Did you walk out of the bar and look at how he got into a vehicle with other people down the street?
No, we did not.
Are you able to tell this body what exactly happened after he left the bar?
No, we are not.
To your knowledge, well, since you can't discuss it with other people, and did you tell the prosecutor's office this?
Yes.
And are you willing to testify in court if the prosecutor's office needs you to testify?
Yes.
No further
questions. Okay, then, no, I have no questions to you. I want you, if she's satisfied that she's provided this governing body with all mitigating information regarding that unfortunate situation?
Yes.
Okay, then my last question, sir, again, is, and I would just respectfully ask you to reconsider because we will be hearing, I believe, from residents. Is it your understanding from your client that they are conforming to the requirements of the conditions that have been previously set regarding their tavern?
I'm just going to repeat my statement.
Okay.
I can hear the laughter in the background.
What
I've said to you, because I'm not trying to come across as a liar or being disingenuous. No system is 100% correct. And for me to say it's been 100% compliance would be a lie. And I'm not going to lie to the body.
No.
When we look at a CAD, yes, there's issues with parking. There's a number of parking tickets. That's why we want to take care of the parking issues.
Let me ask you about the CAD situation that you raised. As you know, I provided you with a list of CADs.
Yes.
The good news, it appears to me that the number of CADs are down significantly. But then again, this is only May. We haven't hit the full year. You've had a chance, sir, I believe, to look at those CAD reports. The governing body has looked at these CAD reports. I'm too lazy, and it's too late for me to go through every CAD. What I want to ask you, sir, is do you have any information you want to provide to this governing body regarding CADs, which deal primarily with noise, garbage, and loud music, at least to the best of my knowledge? Is there any mitigating circumstances you or your licensee want to provide to this governing body regarding those complaints?
If I'm not mistaken, it's my recollection, I think maybe two or three about garbage. And then the issue was, I believe if you read a CAD, they reported that it was other people that left the garbage because they don't sell that type of liquor, and it's something.
Don't worry about that.
They don't sell that type of liquor.
I must be honest with you, as I try to be, garbage didn't really come up. What I remember most of all was loud music. And I'm going to need you to respond to the loud music, because one of the things this governing body could consider as a condition is the elimination of all live music. I don't know if they're going to do that. And the other thing is the disposal of bottles on people's lawns, revving up at engines, and I'm sure we're going to hear from them. What I'm asking you, and you may want to take a moment to confirm with your client, I know what's coming, and I'm trying to give you the benefit of everything I can. Would you please tell this governing body, what about the CAD reports? Is there any information? They've read the CAD reports. Is there anything you want to provide to this governing body as to those reports? And you might want to confer with your client. I leave that to you, sir.
As you know.
I don't know anything. Please go on.
As you know, it's almost impossible for any business to have their customers 100% comply with the rules of the neighborhood. I don't believe there's any business in this town, in this county, in this state that has 100% compliance. So I see that you're trying to hold them to a higher level. What I said at the beginning of my statement was, what we're asking for, if we're willing to, it's a private-public partnership. If we're given an opportunity to get an additional police detail, that way the police would be there. They're going to pay for that special detail. So now there's no issue.
We slipped off the ropes again, sir. We haven't gotten yet to perspective. What I'm asking you is, and I think you're aware of the law of the ABC, which requires, and there's a bevy of case law coming out of Newark and Camden and other municipalities, that the tavern is responsible for the conduct of their patrons as they exit the facility. And what I'm asking you again, and I have some impatience here among my governing body, would you please explain to me, when the assertions are made that your patrons leave drunk, loud, noisy, throwing bottles, and loud music, is there any mitigating circumstances that this governing body should consider? It's your call, sir.
I believe some of the CAD that you provide.
Go ahead, sir. I'm listening.
I believe some of the CAD that you provide even have them calling the police saying, look, we have an issue. Our security can't deal.
I think you're right. Sir, I thank you. What I'd ask Mayor now, we get to the fourth part, which is to our residents of Kenilworth who have something pertinent to say regarding the potential licensing of this facility to come forward, and you certainly have the right to do cross-examination if you so desire. Usually it's not, but that's going to be your call.
Yeah. In anticipation of some of the residents, because I know some of their complaints, I watched the meeting from, I believe, September 26th. I reviewed the minutes from September 10th to August 22nd, so I understand what they're going to say. That's why when I came out here, I was trying to be from left, because I understand the issues they're going to talk about, the same issue. We have concerns about quality of life, we have concerns about kids, and once again, that's why I'm trying to be proactive, because they can't block the entire block off. But what we can do with the assistance of the police, we could pay for us a special detail that would eliminate that issue.
Well, I know you're trying to be proactive. I call it anticipatory. But my question to you is, as far as being proactive, since you, as a judge would say, since you've opened that door, do you want to check with your client as to if, in fact, a penalty is issued regarding the closure of the facility? But more importantly, would your client be inclined to accept a condition that no live music, no, and I'm showing my age here, no DJ, none of that would participate, because that's certainly something that this governing body may consider to resolve the problems that they think are going to come up. Don't answer that yet. I think you want to hear what the residents have to say, talk to them, and then this governing body may not want to do that.
I just want to make sure I have this correct. So if they spend approximately $10,000 or more to get the building soundproof so that there's no noise coming out of the building, you would still want no DJ.
You're asking me. I didn't bet on the Kentucky Derby.
I think we're getting way out of hand here.
Yeah.
We want the residents to talk now. We understand your position. You said you wanted to be proactive. We should have been proactive when we went this last year. Now you're coming with the soundproof thing. Only because we got this here, and now you want to soundproof the doors, which we said back in the last one, that's a way of doing it. Changing the door, putting the divider out there or something, which they never did. So we understand that. So now let's get the residents up here. I want to tell the residents, you come up here, I don't want no laughing, no clapping, no nothing. State your business, go back and sit down. I don't want interruptions, you got it? I don't want both sides going back and forth. We've dealt with this the last time you guys came up. I want it nice, clean. State your names, state your business, say what the issues are, and we'll decide what has to be done. So that's where we're at. We're going back and forth with the same. Yes, let's move on.
Ready for any residents who
want to
come up? Just line up and please, for the clerk, give the clerk your name and address.
My name is Hubert DeBell. I live at 287 South Michigan Ave, Calhoun, New Jersey. So my issue with the bars, okay. I live like down the street from the bar. My issue is not with the bar, with the way the patrons come out of the bar. They're loud. I've seen people urinate in front of my house. I find beer cans in front of my house. That's because people drink in their cars before they go to the bar because it's so expensive in there. So they want to get a few drinks before they go in there. Garbage and noise. Like, I have two little kids that go to school, and they usually go to sleep at 9 o'clock at night. Between 12 and 2 o'clock in the morning, people come out of that bar, and they're loud. You tell them to be quiet, you ask them to be quiet, they just curse you off. It's the people that go to that bar, they don't live in this town. They don't live in this community. So they don't care what's going on. They don't care about the neighborhood. They don't really care. They just come to the bar, drink, and they go home. And just the bar is just it's a bad place for that bar. That bar should not be there. That license should be suspended. They should not get that license. I beg you guys to take that license away, because it's a problem. It's a nuisance to our neighborhood. That's all I gotta say. Thank you.
May I ask some questions?
Sure.
So you're saying that there's police detail out here. The police detail stops people from making noise. That's not enough. You just want to get rid of the bar.
Yes, sir. Because I actually work for the sheriff's office. One police officer is not going to help. One police officer is going to stay in front of the bar. My house is down the street. If somebody's urinated from my house, that cop is not going to see it. But if I call the police department, by the time somebody gets there's going to be tellers and he's gone.
And
same thing with the noise.
And approximately how far is your house?
Maybe it's about 50 yards from the bar.
50 yards.
And also, my promise.
So I just want to make sure. So you're saying you don't believe that your police department is good enough that if they have a detail out there to stop it?
Unless they have five cops walking around there till 3 o'clock in the morning. Five police officers.
So,
because it's not just my street, it's streets all the way around the bar. So, cop might be on one end, he's not going to see what's going on the other side of the bar. He's not going to run over there if he gets a call. Plus, a lot of people will sit in their cars and they'll blast their music in their cars for like 5-10 minutes at midnight, 11 o'clock at night. And that's just so annoying. And if we call the police department, chief knows, they know how many times I call my driver, he gets flagged all the time. All the time, people don't hear, they just block my driveway. My daughter comes home at 11 o'clock, she can't even pull in the driveway, she can't even park on the street. She has to park like 3 blocks away, because of the bar.
So you're saying you want a security detail to
I don't know, I don't want the bar dead.
No,
I don't want the bar dead, period, sir.
Okay.
Let us move forward.
Okay.
Next. Do you have anything else, sir, that's relevant to this?
I'm sorry?
Anything else that's relevant?
It's noise, sir. It's noise, bar, the people that go there, they do not live in the neighborhood, they don't care about the neighborhood. I still, even this year, I found somebody urinated from my house. I found garbage and beer cans from my house, and they can say it's from a pizza place because it's a food that they bring out of the bar. Because I don't see any garbage at night when I walk away from my house. Next morning when I come out, I see garbage from my house. And that's the only place that's...
Sorry, we do have a lot of people.
Yeah, I'm
talking.
What day of the week was the bar open past 11?
Past 11, almost every night.
Mm-hmm. And you are aware that the bar closes 4 days per week at 11?
Mm-hmm. I don't know about that. Because there's people after midnight yelling, screaming from my house, sir. So where they... You tell me it's closed. Apparently it's not, because that's the only place that's open. It's the bar. You can see the lights are still on in there.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
My name is Yulia Ruchkina. I live on 292 South Michigan Avenue, apartment C.
You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
Yes. Well, the main concern is the noise, definitely, and definitely more than five times I called the police because the music's been playing after 1:30 at night, very loud. I have a six-year-old, she goes to school, I go to college, I work full-time, and I can't sleep at night, so I call constantly. Maybe I call less than I called before, but I still call at least once a week to the police department because it's been loud. People are screaming, cursing out, arguing. Sometimes they even cover in the Michigan Avenue because people would be like arguing right in the middle of the street. So of course, by the time you call the police and by the time they arrive, no one is there anymore because they usually leave by the time the police arrives. But yeah, the music, cursing, screaming, garbage. One time I was babysitting my grandmother's dog. I walked down the street. My dog picked up all the garbage, I think, that it was on that Fairfield street. I don't live on Fairfield, I live in Michigan, but it was a lot of garbage. It was food, bottles, condoms. It was everything, glass, right in front of the people's houses. It's just concerning, and raising children in this kind of situation is very not nice.
Thank you for your comments.
Excuse me, ma'am, I want to ask you a question. Do you remember writing, I'm a neighbor across the street. I do not know about other neighbors and their complaints, but I wanted to say big thank you for working with me for the past months and keeping the music not terrible in my house
yes.
After 7 years.
And right after that
really
comment, it was everything went down the hill again, and I have called the police in the same week like three times. Mm-hmm. I did comment to that because we've heard that the meeting is coming, and I actually did say that to the owner of the bar because the music did went down for quite a good time. It was about a month. I wasn't complaining at all. But then, as soon as it got warm, it got all back on right now. And I would say I haven't called the past probably a week or two because I haven't been really staying home a lot. I was out with my parents, and I can say I haven't really complained, but it's been really bad. The loudness and the noises. The school is gone now, so I'm not really complaining anymore because I'm not home. But when the school was on, I had a big trouble with that.
Thank you. Can we hear from the next witness?
Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Anna Bottiglioni, and I live at 693 Fairfield Avenue, Kenilworth, New Jersey.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but
the truth? I do. I'm the tenant that lives right next door to the bar, and I have to tell you, as I was leaving my house tonight, there was loud music playing. I'm currently battling an illness, which I've been battling for a year. Rest is very essential to my well-being, and I have to tell you, I spend four nights out of the week at my sister's house because the noise is unbearable. Just the other night, I went to bed early with hopes of getting some rest, and I had people that were coming out of the bar, walking across my lawn, startled me out of my bed, fighting and yelling back and forth. When I opened the window and asked them to kindly be quiet, I was told to shut the F up. About 2 weeks ago, I was coming home, and it must have been around 11:30 from one of my part-time jobs, and there were two people in the car having sex.
The next morning I wake up and there were condoms in front of my door. So, yeah, there's a lot of noise. It's continuously, it's 4 nights out of the week that I'm home, that I can testify to. It's unbearable. It's unbearable, the disgustingness of it all. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you, ma'am. Can we have the next witness?
State your name and address for the record.
Camilo Dos Santos, 675 Fairfield.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and
nothing
but the
truth?
Yes.
Yes. After the meeting on September 26th, I did monitor because I work from home. I'm literally in my living room all day long, and I observed for 1 week somebody every day around 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon after the bar picking up garbage for 1 week. The sign, so beautiful that they put that sign, it hasn't been up since September. She put it up the last 2 weeks because of this meeting. It hasn't been up. The noise, yesterday, there was a huge fight in front of my house. Yes, call the cops. But by the time they get there, it's gone. Like, there's nothing for them to witness. So I'm going to start calling just to record that there is. There was a fight. A woman yelling, help me, take your hands off me, or whatever, in front of my house. This was around 10:15 at night. The other day on Monday, first nice day of the week, my daughter comes home and she says, Mommy, can I ride my bike outside? I told her no, because there were cars going up and down the street. Up and down the street, they come up opposite, you know, that one block is one way. So that one block, I don't know, maybe put a bigger sign showing do not enter, because clearly people cannot read and do not see that sign, do not enter. They come up and down, up and down. They make U-turns in the middle of our driveways. They're loud. It was that Monday night that I was in front of my house, and they were talking really loud in front of my house, and I flickered the light. And I do that. I don't open the door to tell them to be quiet. I flickered the light because, you know, sometimes you see signs and you stop. The answer, and I wait, and then I open the door, and then the woman goes, what? I'm like, can you please? She goes, shut the up. That's the answer we get from the patrons from the bar. I don't hear the noise, like I said in my last statement. I don't hear the noise from the corner. It's not loud enough for it to bother me. But the problem is not that. It's the garbage. My husband's not here, but he has videos. And it's, don't say, oh, we don't sell that liquor. It's still the patrons from the bar. It's still them. Where are their surveillance? They said they were going to put a security guard to monitor. They were going to pay a security guard weekly to monitor, to walk their patrons to their car to make sure that they are not making noise. And it's not there. Where is that security guard? Where's the off-duty police officer that they were going to pick from their liking to put there? I don't see that. If there was somebody there, I don't think these people would be making the noise that they do. And it's really disturbing because my daughter, like I said, her window is in the front of the house. And yesterday, when I heard the noise yesterday, I was in the back of my house. And I heard the screaming in the bathroom. So you have to walk through my whole house to where I was. I was in the back of the house to hear the screaming. My daughter comes down, Mommy, can I come and lay down with you and Daddy? Because I can't sleep. And she's up, my other daughter, she's up at 6:30 in the morning to go to school. And they can't. And it's, don't tell me that the bar closes at 11 o'clock at night. Okay, your bar closes at 11 o'clock at night, but the problem is their patrons hang around. And where are the people to stop their patrons, tell them to get in the car and leave? That's my concern. They're not doing what they said on September 26th that they were going to do. They do not have anybody picking up the garbage. I have the videos, the pictures, but it's not with me. My husband's the one that goes around and he's picking up the garbage on the weekends, especially on Sundays and Saturdays and Sundays. In the morning, he's going around and picking up garbage. And I do not see somebody from their bar coming over. And don't tell me, oh, they come. It's not at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. My lawn's not going to be dirty all day long until your bar opens and decides to come and pick it up. You should be picking that up first thing in the morning. I shouldn't have to walk out of my house and out of my driveway with my children with beer bottles and condoms in front of my driveway. The dogs eat the condoms. They're eating the condoms. Because it's not just one condom, it's not two condoms, it's several people. And again, I will ask maybe for the town to put lights up. Because where it's dark, trust me, where it's dark is where people go to do things wrong. And it's a very dark corner.
It's a very dark area right there. And that's, you know, they fight, and yesterday, by the time we decided to call, they had already left. And they pulled into my driveway to do a U-turn or to whatever. That's what really started me to, you know, to go out and see what was going on, because they were pulling into my driveway. They don't care. Called the cops already because they blocked my driveway. Oh, I only went in there to get food. No, you didn't go in there. I knocked when you went in, and by the time you got out, that was like a good hour and a half. So
I don't want to cut you off, but I know we have a large number of people who want to put their statements on the record. So I thank you.
Is it your testimony that there's no security guard outside?
It is my testimony that I do not see a security guard walking the patrons like you guys said in September we were going to do.
So if the police were to put in a cab that they spoke with a security officer.
One cop is not going to do it.
I'm saying to you, if the police were to put in a cab that they spoke with security, they would be alive.
I'm sorry? Can you repeat it?
If the police were to put in a cab that they came there in response to a complaint and they spoke with security, they would be alive.
If they spoke to security, maybe at the door, but not in the front. I can't speak for what the cops spoke to your cab for your security department. I can't speak. I can tell you that I do not see your security officer or whatever that you have there. I can speak for me, not for you.
For instance, on Friday night, did you see the two guys outside in black?
In front of my house? No, I did not.
Did you see the two
not
guys
in front of my house?
In front of the bar at about doing the rounds at about 8:30, 9 o'clock.
Oh, wow. 8:30, 9 o'clock. Okay.
Did you see that?
No, because 8:30, 9 o'clock, nobody's making noise. We're talking about the noise after 10, 11 o'clock at night. Are they there at 10, 11 o'clock at night?
Your
doing
testimony
the rounds?
Is that you've never seen security.
I have never. My testimony is I, Camilla DeSanto, the 675 Fairfield Avenue, have never seen a security guard for the Galveston. If that's what you want.
And you're saying there's none that walk outside.
Not that I have seen.
I think we beat this established.
Yeah, we're good.
Okay, I think that, sir, come up.
My name is Richard Price. I live at 290 South Michigan Avenue, Kenilworth, New Jersey. Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Sir, I want to focus everyone. You've heard the testimony here tonight. Could you, and I think most of the residents have, can you focus on the issue of the conditions that you feel are or not being conformed to by this tavern?
I don't remember the last time, the date that we were here, but I know you represented us, and there was only...
Well, I represented the borough, but go ahead.
Okay, there was only four of us that said no, no deal, no deal, no deal. And but other people wanted to give them a break and let them do this and that. And unless I wasn't hearing right, I could have sworn they said they were supposed to hire a police officer for a minimum of $70 an hour or something for when certain times or something. I've never seen a police officer. I haven't seen a mall cop. I haven't seen nothing. All I see is the two, assuming they're bouncers. They wear black shirts, two of them guys. They're two very nice guys, matter of fact. I've talked to them. And I told them, you know, they do a very good job of containing people in front of the bar. But downstairs, from in front of my house, they just will not go home. They sit there with the music blasting and going big loud, and you know, they just don't go home, you know, and it's like it didn't stop. The same thing just happened all over again. I mean, back in the 70s, in the disco days, they had people where as soon as it closed, they were like, let's go, let's go, let's go. You ain't gotta go home, but you gotta get out of here. You know, and I ain't seen none of that.
Sir, you have any questions, please?
Did they ever hire a police officer? I don't know. I haven't seen one.
Do you have any questions?
Sir, let me ask you a question. Because you said you haven't seen a police officer. Did you ever go up and ask the two men that walk around whether or not they're in fact police officers?
No, I talked to him yesterday. I should have.
But did you ask him what apartment he works for?
No, he said he just started working there 2 weeks ago.
Did you ask him whether
or not? No,
no further questions.
Okay.
Next, ma'am.
Karen Colbeck, 682 Fairfield Ave. I was going to make this short and sweet. Music, to me, is the worst of my worries right now. I'm worried about the loud noise late at night, the drinking in their cars. You can't tell me they're not drinking in their cars because I've got pictures of alcohol bottles that I'm picking up off of lawns. They say they have people cleaning it up. Sunday morning, I saw a Corona bottle on the side of the road. Tonight, it's still there. So nobody's picking up all this garbage. I don't know what they're talking about. Parking, they have this little sign that they just started putting out again. And then you say you have security guys coming out and telling them they can't park there? Why are motorcycles parked there? Nobody does anything. And I have to say, I've seen cops drive by and nothing's been done. I have more pictures of alcohol. Here's the Corona bottle with the red Solo cup. Rules to comply about drinking. They're drinking in their cars, obviously, with all these liquor bottles. I don't have time to sit there and take pictures of all the liquor bottles and the garbage that is left all over the street. It's disgusting. We shouldn't have to pick it up as residents. We pick up our own garbage. I'm not going to pick up somebody else's garbage.
Sorry, you have any questions?
What time was that picture taken with Musa?
This was 2 nights ago. The day is still daylight.
2 nights ago, but it's still daylight.
Yeah, but it's if you look. It doesn't matter,
daylight or
not.
It's in the yellow zone.
It's
a yellow curve, so they should get tickets. It's no parking within 25, 50 feet.
No parking on the
side. You understand that they could tell people not to park, right?
Why are they?
But are you saying that you want them, even though they tell people don't park here, even though they put a sign, you want them to physically remove the people?
I want them to move their vehicles where they're not supposed to be parked. If I parked there, I'd be sure to get a ticket.
So if they have a police detail that's able to do this, would that satisfy you? Because
no.
You're saying you're concerned about the parking.
Parking?
And what I'm trying to come up with is a solution. And what I'm getting is, even if they had 5 police officers there patrolling, you just don't want a bar, no matter. So it's not a security issue. It's not
no,
a garbage
issue. No, it is a security
issue. You just don't want a bar.
It is a security issue because of what's going on the street. Last night, 10:15 at night, people screaming. Their windows were up in their car, and I heard them inside my house.
And so you want the bar to be responsible for what people do in their private car?
Well, you just said you would have somebody walking up and down the road.
Yeah, but I'm saying,
yeah.
Walk up and down. Just like police come by, and they gotta tell people, you gotta leave. And the people, after they drive off, still turn the noise. You're saying you want a bar to be responsible for what those people do in their car, whether or not they choose to disobey the police, or the security officers, or police officers.
Well, they're letting their patrons are drinking in their cars.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
My name's Pete Doe. I live at 682 Fairfield Avenue. Our right hand? Left hand? It's been a long time. I do. So help me God, yes. I don't want to see anybody lose their business. I really don't. I'm a small business owner. I grew up in Summit in a contracting family. I don't want to get crazy here, but parking is just like an issue for respect to me. I mean, I moved to Kenilworth 3 years ago with my 2 20-year-old kids. My daughter works in Summit, where I grew up, in a restaurant, and she comes home late at night. The parking is, everything else everybody said, sure, yeah, I can swear to that, whatever. We don't need to go over that again. But the parking is just, you know, I rent, I pay high rent. I don't mind. I can pay it, thank God. But when I come home and I can't park, it just it gets me upset. It really does. I don't know, is that stupid to think of? I mean, I didn't know that we, you know, couldn't fit the cars we had to. So when my daughter comes home late at night, she's got to park 200 yards away, 150 yards away in the rain or whatever. It upsets me that somebody can have a business. I'm a plumber. If I go to a house, I'm going to borrow your tools to do the job. If you have a business, I mean, I don't know, most places I know, and I work in a lot of commercial restaurants and stuff like that, you have ample parking. I don't even know if this is an issue, but that's the thing that kills me, that somebody can have a place that where they're making tons of money, but they can take my spots that I'm paying rent for, sort of. I mean, it's a public street, I guess. I don't know. I guess That's the thing that's just, it's crazy. I come home and I got to pull my truck into, 50 yards, 100 yards away from my house. I like to park in my driveway. My kids are in the driveway. They have no place to park, so I got to park on the street. That's the problem I have. That's all. I mean, everything else everybody said is true. But why, if you have a business, and I don't want anybody to lose their business. Anybody that has a business deserves to work hard and make their money, whatever they got to do. But the responsibilities, and there's somebody in this room that I grew up with, that if you park near, and your shadow of your car was near the driveway, the police were called, and you got screamed at, blah, blah, blah. And I'm not being disrespectful. And I agreed with this person whenever I saw it happen.
Sir, I need you to stay relevant.
All right.
To the
what I'm saying is, why, I don't understand. If you have a business, I don't know, why can't there be a rented spot or whatever? I don't know. Maybe it's crazy. Or am I allowed to park in somebody else's parking lot if I'm doing a job in another building? I don't know. Maybe it sounds crazy. I don't know. But since I've moved there, I'm just saying, it's totally changed. I can't park in front of my house. My kids can't park. We got to park, 150, 200 yards away.
Sorry, I don't mean to cut, but I really want to move along. Sir, do you have any questions for this witness?
I mean, why would, if you have a successful bar, why can't you
figure
out? No,
that's
what
I'm saying.
So let me add to it. If we were to do like other towns do, and there was to be a restriction, no non-resident parking without a permit.
If anybody that went to your place or whoever's place and could not park on Fairfield Avenue, I'd be wearing bells and whistles.
That's
all
I care about. I don't care if we were even looking at ordinance where they said no non-residents are able to park in this area. Would that help?
It would definitely help. And if you got tickets, I'm just saying, if nobody abides by it, like you go to Hoboken, you park in places.
Sir, we better stay out.
I'm just saying.
Sir, I really try to be open and frank. Number one, let me make the point. They are not passing ordinances. This governing body does ordinances.
I understand.
That's for you and the council. Can we move on, please, to the next witness?
Is there any way that a bar could have parking somewhere else and not on the street where they are?
I don't know.
Okay.
Thank you. Can we move on to the next one?
No problem. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. I want to be respectful to everyone.
My name is Madison Vanek. I live at 642 Fairfield Avenue.
Sorry to tell the truth.
I do. So I live at 642 Fairfield Avenue. It's on the second half of the block past the intersection of Fatute. By the way, I'm here representing my dad, David Vanek, who I'm sure we all know. If he was here, he would be, or he's been very in this issue for a very long time. Two of the issues that were very relevant were not addressed since the previous council meeting that this was addressed in, were the patrons being walked to their vehicles and on their merry way, and then cleaning up litter. I have pictures of alcohol bottles, condoms. I know that many of us have seen these patrons in their vehicles drinking, doing drugs, having sex every single weekend. And so if there was someone actually bringing them to their vehicles and telling them, hey, time to leave, then they would be on their way and that wouldn't be an issue, but there's no one doing that. There's also no one cleaning up garbage. There's the same alcohol bottles there all the time, all the way down the end of the street. Like, they're not even just parking on this first block, they're parking on the second side, they're parking at the end of the street. And they're blocking up all this parking, they're doing all of these things all the way down the street. They're also driving up and down the street very fast, down the wrong way and the one way. They're racing back and forth because they don't realize that the second half is a dead end. It's again the same with the illegally parked cars that are blocking residents from parking in front of their own houses or parking in front of driveways. It's the people yelling in the middle of the night. Two or three nights ago, I heard people yelling at midnight, just screaming at each other, a group of four people. Obviously, there was something. They weren't fully within themselves, and they were walking to a car, and they were driving away. And if they're leaving the bar drunk, in their own cars, then things like that happen where someone could get killed.
I thank you, Pico. Sir, do you have any cross examination witness?
And your father was party to a complaint where it's alleged that he threw a bottle at somebody in the bar?
Yes.
So now let me ask you.
Well, that's not relevant, sir. That's not relevant. I try to give flexibility. I have a counsel that's angry with me for letting this go on. But that's not relevant. The issue is not what her father may or may not have done. Sir, you know the issue, and I would ask you to limit your comments to that testimony.
Sort of bias is always relevant.
I am not responsible for that.
I understand. I just asked a question about your dad. Now,
period.
I'm going to move on to something that's more relevant.
Okay.
If we were to get a parking ordinance passed to where there was no parking on your street, would that help?
Only if there was about 10 police officers who were also patrolling the street, making sure no one parked there, and making sure no one was doing illegal behaviors on the street or around the area.
Okay. Thank you.
So let me again say for the record, I don't see any support on this governing body, and I don't want to deceive you, for any ordinance changes. The issue before the governing body tonight is whether or not the license of this applicant should be renewed, and whether there should be conditions, and whether there should be suspensions. I haven't polled the governing body, but I can tell. I don't see any indication whatsoever, and since I'd be the guy directing the ordinance, I'd probably know. I don't see any indication by this governing body to permit any ordinances regarding parking or anything else. The issues are noise, and the issues you've heard so well.
I'm sorry for annoying you. The only reason why I asked...
You're not annoying me. You're wasting time. You're not annoying me.
I understand. I've looked at other meetings where I saw people doing ordinance, but no left turn in certain areas. I don't know what was considered when all those things were passed. I've seen various different parking ordinances where things passed in various minutes. So all I'm trying to do is for us to collectively come to a solution. You're saying I'm wasting my time, but I'm trying... find a solution where everybody says.
Let me try to help you, sir. Here's the solution. Very shortly, when these witnesses are done, this governing body is going to consider if they want to make any conditions on your license, if they want the license renewed, or if they don't. I would strongly suggest that you focus your comments on what we can do to help these residents with security, noise, and those relevant issues. That's certainly what I'm urging you to do, but it's up to you. This is your show, sir. You can do whatever you like. Ma'am, let's get the next witness in.
Please state your name and address for the record.
Anna Ferreira, 332 South Michigan Avenue. Is where it's through to hold your money to the street? Yes. Yes. My thing is, if they have security there, like they're stating, yesterday night at about 10:15, there was a lady outside screaming, help me, get off me. To me, that was like, she was scared. I thought she was getting raped. I did call the police. Three cop cars did come right away. They stopped the car. Now, if security was outside the building, wouldn't they have heard the same thing that I heard inside my house? I live on the stream, right next to the stream on Lexington. They come out of the bar. There's liquor bottles there, Hennessy. There is bottles there. I know that you don't sell it there, but they come from their cars. They drink outside their cars, and they throw the bottles there. My husband does pick it up. We always clean that stream.
Can I interrupt you just for a second? Because this issue has been raised by a number of residents. If these patrons, allegedly, are drinking before they're going into the bar, why are they going into the bar if they're drinking before they go in?
I think they're doing it after they're kicked out of the bar. They're coming outside, drinking outside on the side because it's dark over there. And they're drinking more before they leave. They make all this noise. They peel out and they have...
Can I ask you another question? Do you think that the problem is the live music that's coming, emulating, is that the word, that's coming out of the bar? Do you
yeah.
think that's the problem?
I hear the, now that it's spring, I do have my windows open, so I do hear the noise louder. In the winter, I didn't hear it, but now that it's getting better, I do hear it. I hear the cars peeling off.
Well, and I don't mean to interrupt you, but I am trying to move it along. Are you saying that, is it your opinion, that the attraction to this facility and the noise it emulates is because of the live music?
Yes.
Please go on.
Yes, it is. That's what is attracting everybody to the bar, is the loud music and the people that are coming there to perform or whatever they're doing.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir, do you have any questions for me? Now, let me just correct for the record. I'm showing my age again. The live music I talk about is the DJ. I don't think they have
You don't have a live band.
No, not. It's DJ. I have to be corrected. I'm showing my age.
Jukebox.
Jukebox. You're showing
Anthony,
your
Anthony Capari, 103 South 25th Street.
Do
you swear
to tell the truth?
I don't.
The truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
So help you
God? Yes, I do.
Thank you.
Okay. I tried to prepare a statement just to be clear, because I had filed a complaint for the noise, and I want to be clear about all that. I managed the property 29292 South Michigan Avenue, just across the street from the bar. A lot of people, we've been very patient in the last few years since they've been open. The noise has been higher than the legally required level. I have taking the time patiently listening to my tenants, the complaints of them here tonight. Others voiced their concerns as well. I did my research. I paid attention to the renewal hearings. The last year, the complaints, the ABC hearing in September. I have put out video cameras. I've provided evidences to back up what I say. Right now, I see this place as being in violation of NJ 13.2-23.6, which is regards to the basic nuisances. The law reads, prohibits rude and immoral activity, brawls, and nuisances on or about the licensed premises. A licensee's responsibility.
I don't need you.
Oh, sorry. Oh, fine.
You get it. Believe me, this governing body knows that regulation. They could probably recite it to you.
Listen, my two issues here tonight are, I mean, if I wonder about everyone else talk, because the residents, I don't live there, but I have to go down there and deal with this, is noise and loitering afterwards. I had a discussion with Jessica, and she kind of felt like once they're off her lot, these people don't have a problem. But once they go a block, two blocks, if they have no parking, somebody's parked three blocks down the street because there's no really organized parking, that person causes trouble down there because they're drinking. They're drinking. They're at least a little drunk. They're right. Let's be honest. They have some alcohol in the system. They cause problems. The neighbor has to call the police. And then, of course, by the time the police get there, a lot of times these people take off, or it's like, they just go. And it's 12:39. They've been awoken. They've been disturbed. It's ruins their quality of life. Okay, so I need those things, the noise and this whole thing about closing and parking, settled before this town can renew this license. And I'm really very concerned that because I think they're out of compliance with the state regulations. And I'm really concerned that if this borough does renew this and they're not in compliance, the borough itself could be at risk of being. If something happens,
let me respond to that. The regulations you have cited,
yes,
and again, this governing body is intimately aware of that, you're dealing with nuisance. I don't want to go from apples to oranges.
Right.
And by that I mean parking is a separate issue. And I don't know that this...
That's fine. The point is, if they park in front of somebody's house and then they come back drunk in front of somebody's house, then guess what? You're going to get a complaint from somebody's house.
Well, the point I'm trying to make to you, sir, is the nuisance was something this governing body dealt with in October. I anticipate they may very well deal with it again. The issue that seems to be coming across tonight is noise emulating from the tavern.
Sure.
But I just wanted to caution you, nuisance regulations do not spill over, no pun intended, to parking. And I just want to make that point to you. Sir, do you have any cross-examination for this week?
I'm just a planning guy, so I kind of follow these things.
Thank you. Next, coming to the end.
Please state your name and address for the records.
Luis Cicada, 693 Fairfield Avenue.
Swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Yes, sir. Can I help you, God?
Good evening. I don't want to go over for what everybody has said all night. I just want to pass it out some proof.
Would you give it to the clerk? Oh, no. That's right. Ma'am, for the record, and I would like the gentleman over here again, what is it that you're giving, because this is being filmed, what is it that you're giving the governing body to review?
Those are pictures of proof, people parking on the yellow line. Yes, it is true, she has put the sign up, but as you can see, there are motorcycles between the signs. If it's security there, they should be correcting people. He mentioned that it's not their job to tell them. But we were here in September, we were promised that the security was going to fix all these problems, and we never saw any results. It is true. We want the bar closed because we've been through a lot. We don't want to hear all the excuses anymore. Unfortunately, we don't believe what she has to promise to us. We don't want to hear about parking because we don't believe it. We're tired. We've been going through this for 2 years. My big concern is, as a mother, and 13 kids in my block, actually 15 because two just moved in recently. What is going to happen next? One of our kids is going to get hurt because these people, they're speeding down the street, unfortunately. Is this what we're waiting for? For somebody willing to get hurt? Somebody already lost her life. Now, I don't know, can I ask him something? Can I ask him something?
No, it's the other way around. He asked you questions.
Well, I want to know, he mentioned before that 4 nights out of the week it was closed.
Let me try to help you. Is it your experience that the tavern is closed 4 nights of the week?
No, that's why I was curious, because he expressed that before, and I want to know where the nights that are closed.
Is it your experience that the tavern is open every night?
Yes, it is. I live next door to the bar, so 100% I know.
Is it your experience that the noise that is emulating from that tavern is coming from the loud music?
Yes, it is.
Okay, but
yes, I just wanted to make sure because he said that it was four nights that it was closed.
Gentlemen, I have some questions for you.
Now, are you asking me whether or not I said the tavern closes 4 nights a week at 11?
Oh, okay. Okay.
That clarifies.
Okay.
Anything else, ma'am?
One more question. He was asking the other people, the other neighbors, about the security. We don't know who the security are because it's probably 10 sometimes people hanging outside. How do we know who is the security? They don't have signs in the back. We don't see these people coming down the street to tell them to leave. That was fun for us in September, that they were going to make sure they were going to leave. Now, something else I want to mention. Sorry, I almost forgot. As a former bartender, and I'm in the restaurant business, they mentioned that they're not responsible for the people that leave after they leave the establishment. They are. Actually, for you as a bartender, if somebody's drinking too much, it's your responsibility to stop serving that person because they're too intoxicated. So I want to correct that when they mentioned that they didn't know when they left. It's your responsibility.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir?
So, I just want to get this clear. What you're looking for the security to do is basically cordoning off the roads and stop people from going under the street.
I'm not looking for anything because that was promised to us in September. And unfortunately, I don't know if I can speak behalf of the other neighbors. We don't believe it anymore. Because Friday we saw results the first 2 weeks when that meeting happened in September, and after that, everything was back to normal.
And so you're saying you're on a Fairfield, you've walked because you want to make sure they're in compliance, and you've walked out to the front, and you've never seen security out front.
I don't know if the people on the outside hanging out is security. I don't know who they are because they don't have t-shirts that it says security. I don't know who these people are. It's always people hanging outside, but I cannot tell you that's the security.
But you were concerned. And you wanted to make sure they were compliant, right? So in an effort to make sure they were compliant, did you go in to see if there was actually security?
So that's not my job to go outside. Like I'm saying to you, I saw people hanging outside. I don't know if that's the security
which sometimes made me wonder if it's the security, why they don't tell these people to go inside the bar? You know what I'm saying? Instead of being loud outside, they security, they should be telling the customers to please be inside the bar because they're being loud, right?
Correct.
Isn't that part of the job?
Right. And in looking at the ads, you do agree there's been numerous times when people called about complaints.
Sure, she may not know what a cat is.
Well, were you aware that there's been times when people called and the police reported, we're right here in the bar. There's no noise. There's no one outside giving problems. We're right here. Were you aware of that?
I don't know. To be honest, because I don't know what happened with the police.
Do you have any other questions? Do any other people relevant for the commission?
No, no.
Sir,
thank you so much.
You're the cleanup.
Mario Rossi, 685 Fairfield Avenue, two doors down from the Galaxy.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes. This is not the first, not the second, but the third council meeting that we're attending here for Galveston. Ms. Quintana has made many promises, none of which were kept. We've suffered enough. They were supposed to put parking sign, resident parking only, no. They were supposed to have a trash patrol, no. They were supposed to have end of night escorts, no. The quality of life issues are for seniors, children, and ladies. There's food stuff left on the lawns, liquor bottles, broken bottles, condoms, leftover drug paraphernalia. Seniors are afraid around their own homes. Children can't play even outside their homes or their driveways. They can't even ride a bike. Your son used to ride next door with the ride his bike next door before Galveston came. He hasn't been there since. Neighbors are parking in each other's driveways and across their driveways out of fear. There's total parking problems, and residents have been receiving tickets and not the transgressors from Galveston. There's public urination on the lawns in full view of residents' windows, pot smoking and drug deals right on the street day and night, and I've observed it. We have 15 children on Fairfield Avenue alone. Galveston has been open two seasons to do things right. A year and a half to solve problems. An entire section of Kenilworth is at stake here. Seniors live in fear, women are open targets, children are restricted to their own homes. If the mayor and the council won't listen, the commission must be the ultimate voice of reason. If the police are overwhelmed with calls, we have a more reason to shut down Galveston. Money should not prevail over our quality of life issues for seniors and children and ladies. Don't abandon Kenilworth residents to gangbangers, drug thugs, and drunk teens. We are hardworking, tax-paying residents who deserve the same quality of life other residents of Kenilworth enjoy. Deny the liquor license and all problems will be solved.
You said something there. Are you saying some of the calls or things that have been attributed to
Galveston?
Was actually people from here getting tickets?
Right.
They were the ones that were illegally parked?
Right. So why weren't those five motorcycles getting tickets?
But you're saying people from your neighborhood, they were giving tickets.
And they have to park in front of the driveways because they're afraid to walk around the streets.
Yeah, I just want to, I understand your concern, but most of these cabs relate to 9, 10, 11 at night. Are you saying you have kids outside riding at that time of night?
They were given tickets for parking daytime.
And you're saying you called in because you're saying the children are at risk because they can't.
One-way drivers going the wrong way, speeding to get out of the street,
and you're
turning into your driveways, and that's what's going to happen. That's the next beating, is when a child gets killed.
And your testimony is that kids are outside riding at 8:30, 9 at night on the street.
Patrons are riding up and down daytime.
But you made a statement about kids being outside riding.
They can't even go past.
Okay, I think that's sir, I'm going to conclude my part, Mayor. I'm going to leave it to you.
And I have witnesses.
If you want to provide your testimony, by all means.
Thank you.
Please state your name and address for the record.
Valeria Piero, 10 North 24th Street.
How long have you lived in this town?
18 years.
How long have you worked at that location?
13 years.
And what exactly is your position, your occupation at that restaurant?
I'm the general manager.
Now, can you tell the members of the committee about what steps you've helped to put in place and what you've seen happen since they were last here?
I have cleaned up the area. I do know the security guards that are there in place every night. And I'm there generally during the day. I have been there at night. I have gone down at night, and I haven't heard excessive noise.
What steps are taken by the security to monitor the noise level?
To my knowledge, they do go out and walk around and make sure people are getting to the cars as quickly as possible and out of the area.
And when you say about garbage pickup, approximately what time do you go outside to pick the garbage?
In the morning, sometimes in the morning.
What time in the morning?
Depends what time I get there. I'm usually there early,
and
8 o'clock in the morning.
Just so members of the council could know, where exactly do you walk and pick garbage up?
Mostly in front of the bar, up Michigan Avenue, where the bus stop is, where most of the garbage is, and there's a lot of people that go to that bus stop, and I've seen the people at the bus stop also leave garbage there.
But we're concerned about it with respect to garbage from the bar.
And generally at Fairfield, I try to clean as much as I can, when I can.
Thank you. Your name again for record, and you were previously sworn, right?
Yes. Marianne Matthews.
And what is your daytime occupation?
I work for Union County Sheriff's Department.
Now, are there police officers employed?
Yes.
How many police officers?
There are 2 police officers employed at Galveston.
And where are these men police officers?
Union County Corrections.
And what are their names?
Eric Williams and Lee, I don't remember his last name. Yeah.
Who hired them?
We did.
And what is their job description?
The officer's job description per the town's requirements were to make sure that they patrol the area, to monitor the noise outside, and to monitor the let out. Officers are not allowed to work inside the bar because we serve alcohol, so their primary function is to be outside to monitor parking after 10 o'clock as the requirement stated, from 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. when we are open, and it's their responsibility to go outside to monitor parking, trash, clients going to and from their cars, and also to make sure that no one's loitering outside during those hours between 10 and 2.
Now, from your own personal knowledge, what have you seen these officers do while you're your personal knowledge?
Okay.
Just what you've seen.
Just to give a little background, I am there Monday night, Wednesday night, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. I'm there on the busiest nights. It's my personal observation. The officers work on Monday nights, Wednesday nights, Friday, and Saturdays. Friday and Saturdays are the only nights that were open past 11 o'clock. Monday nights, it's their responsibility to monitor the sound because we have music. and they get there at around, I believe, 8:30, between 8:30 and 9 o'clock, and they monitor the noise outside. They also monitor the parking because it's extremely busy. So I am there. When they clock in, they come, they see me, they take the decimal reader, they go outside, and they walk the area. That is their responsibility. They stay outside because they are not allowed to be inside. That's part of their restrictions. They cannot come outside. We also have our own security that's inside that monitors the people that come outside. So we have a total of 3 on premises every night after 10 o'clock.
How would people know that the 2 police officers outside, 2 off-duty police officers, per police officer, what if they have identified them as police officers?
They have their badges. Their badges are worn underneath their jacket. And also Kenilworth PD comes every night to ask them to see them. They know them personally because some of them know them from working during the day. So they say, hey, Eric, hey, Lee, whoever. And they always come and they make sure that they're there every night.
Are you sure they stop? How do you know if Kenilworth PD comes by every night?
Because they also come in and say hi to us to let them know that they're outside, just to say, hey, if you guys have any issues, let us know. I can speak. They have their body cameras on. They can prove it, that they come. They say, hey, we're in the area if you need us, just so we know who's working, because a lot of the times there's, like, shift change or whatever, and we don't know what officers are working.
How do you know those body cameras are active?
Because they tell us. They say, they go like this. That's how we know the cameras.
So you're saying there's police officers that come by with body cameras.
Yes.
Recording what's going on.
Yes.
The security in the area.
Yes.
Ma'am, I have a question for you.
Yes.
I think everything you said, I think you're being totally truthful.
Mm-hmm.
Can you please explain to me, if what you're saying is true, why are all these residents so angry? Why are all these residents coming out?
I don't think you want me to answer that question truthfully.
Well, I really do.
Okay.
I think you got it.
All right, no problem. No problem. I will answer to the best of my ability, okay? The biggest issue here, and we have it on tape, and if you'd like us to play it, we can. The biggest issue from your residents is the culture of the people at the bar. And we have it on tape from one of your members in the office that's actually on your zoning board that stated that they have a problem with the culture and those people that are at the bar. Speaking of those people, our night tonight is hosted by the fire department, Orange Fire Department. Every Wednesday night they host. Every Wednesday night. So it's the culture. And if you'd like to hear the video, we can definitely play it, because they said, we don't have a problem unless it's the culture of the people that come to your bar.
Let me respond to that.
Okay.
I don't think culture has a damn thing.
Well, you want to listen to the video?
No, I'd like you to play and answer my question.
I did. I said you didn't want the answer.
Well, I did want the answer.
Okay.
I just don't think it's a valid one.
Oh, do you
want
to hear it?
No, what I was...
Because the gentleman that said it is that
he's going to argue with me all night. It's not helping your court.
I'm not arguing.
What I want to ask you,
mm-hmm,
is, what does culture have to do with condoms, garbage, noise, people peeing on lawns? Can you explain to me that?
Yes.
What does culture have to do
with
that?
We have no physical proof that this happened. We've asked people to show us pictures of condoms, alcohol, things like that. That you can prove that came from our establishment.
Ma'am,
there's
a
lot of
you.
What
was
the
bottom of that?
I can't remember.
No, we're getting
okay. Okay.
Sorry.
No.
If I understand the residents' concern,
mm-hmm,
but I'm not asking you to testify, sir. I'm asking this witness who you called to specifically answer me this question.
And I answered.
Do you really think,
mm-hmm,
that culture has anything
100%
to do with condoms,
100%
garbage, people peeing on their lawn,
100%
and noise?
100%. You asked for my answer. That's my honest answer.
I appreciate your answer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you allow patrons of the bar to take liquor outside the bar?
No, we do not.
Do you allow you to sell beer cans in your bar?
No, we do not.
They're saying they have pictures of alcohol bottles or whatever. Is that the type of things that you sell in your establishment?
No, we do not sell any of those items in our bar.
Do you know where people go to before they come to your establishment?
No, I do not know where people go before they come to Galveston.
No, thanks.
Thank you.
Please state your name and address for the record.
Jessica Quintana, 2028 Dogwood Drive, Scotchman.
Yeah. We all do it, Jessica.
Yes. Yes.
Now, Ms. Quintana.
Yes.
approximately how much did you spend on security?
A week?
Yes.
About $1,000 a week.
Okay. How many, now, these people that are hired, why did you hire them? Why did you hire them?
We originally had two, and they required last time for us to hire an officer, which we did. So normally on the weekends, we have three guards.
And what time do they start working?
They usually get there about 9 o'clock.
Okay, so now, what are their job duties?
We normally have two inside. One stands by the side door, one stands by the front door, one stands outside. What we're trying to do is by fire code, you can't block the front door, so we just have somebody stand there trying to guide them to the side door. So the front door doesn't open, the noise doesn't travel out. On the side door, the guard that's there is checking IDs. The guy that is outside, he is walking around looking. Now, when everybody's saying they wanted us to escort them to the car, right? That was never, it was never, okay.
What did they do to make sure the noise level not a nuisance for the community?
They stand outside. They check down the streets. If there's cars parked in the yellow, we tell them to move.
And what do you mean by you tell them to move?
We go and make an announcement inside. We say there's a example, a white Honda license plate XYZ. Can you please move it?
Now, do they always obey?
Yes, because we keep saying until they move it.
Yes. Have you had help of police sometimes for assistance to people?
Normally, we have video cameras. I can see them from my phone. I'm home sometimes. I look on the camera. I see somebody parked in the yellow. I call the bar myself. I say there's a car parked in the yellow. Please move it because I don't want any issues.
Now, if I get, council is very concerned about fair fee.
Yes.
Okay? And they want mitigating factors. That's what I've heard, right? Because they said you came here in September, came to an agreement in October. How can you assure them that their trust in you and your establishment has not been violated? Because that's what they're looking for. As I heard, he doesn't want to eat for effort. He wants to know what have you done.
Well, since you've raised your question, sir, let me ask. What I think this governing body is looking for, I'll cut to the quick. You heard my question to that young lady over there. If all these efforts you're taking are valid, why do I see such anger in residents of Kenilworth that they're so annoyed? And more importantly, and this is the specific question, what would be the result if, and I have no idea that they will, if this governing body was to end the, I keep calling it disco music, the
DJ.
The DJ. What would be, do you believe that would mitigate a big chunk of the problem?
Okay, so if we want to talk about the CAD reports, which we...
If we did away with music, DJ music,
yes,
in your bar...
What would happen?
What would happen? That's what we're trying to get at. Cut out all noise.
Would that kill your business?
Sure it would.
Yes.
And are there any other bars in this town that have no music?
No.
Jordan?
I mean, they have music.
But is there any other bar?
But this bar specifically was never allowed to have music, and there was a concession made for it, right? Am I right?
But my question is, based on your experience, do other bars have DJs?
Yes.
Who?
One second. Because I heard an interesting point. As council members, if you were to go back to the original thing, if they gave up the concession and they allowed you to operate, keep your license, because they're saying they don't want a DJ. I don't know if they're saying a jukebox, if they want something else. If they're willing to do that, will you comply? Where they're saying, okay, we don't want the heavy bass. We don't want anything that's going to have the neighbors complain. But you're allowed to keep your bar open. You're allowed to serve patrons. But that alleviates the majority of the complaint that this council is facing.
I got rid of the bass bottom. I had a meeting with Mr. Campari, And, you know, they said he was saying you could hear the bass. I got rid of the bass, took it out of the bar.
But
it's gone.
And this is a really important test.
Yes.
You heard your counsel's question. He asked it better than I did. My question is, in addition to the conditions that exist, and maybe there'll be others, but in fact, if this governing body, in their wisdom, were to determine that no DJ, do you believe that would resolve a chunk of the problem for the residents?
No.
I wouldn't.
No.
Because?
Because I don't think that's the only issue that they're having.
Well, do tell. What are the other issues?
They've told you them already, but
do you want to talk to me first?
What I'm asking is what I see going on, and I'm trying to read body language. Everybody wants to avoid that issue. So what I'm trying to get us to come to is a mutual agreement.
Okay, but can I say something? We're not, every CAD report that we have, and when the cops come and they say, they're not all valid. So everything that they're saying is not valid because...
I think that's accurate. I think you're accurate. But let's come back to home plate again.
Okay.
The question, there are conditions, and maybe you're living up to them, maybe you're not. Shame on us if you're not. But the question I'm asking you this evening, if this governing body in their wisdom was to make a requirement, no DJ, is it your opinion that you'd still have an adversarial relationship with the residents? If that's so, then I guess what you're saying to me is this governing body has to come up with tougher requirements, which is what I would like to avoid. So I have to ask you, what happens if this governing body eliminates the DJ?
That's not something I'm willing to give up.
Well, ma'am, I don't know that that's your choice, but okay, thank you.
I mean, I don't even know what you have set forth.
Let me answer your question. Have we discussed possibly using the headsets, right?
We could.
And describe, since I think some of the councilmen
may not know, there's something called, it's called like a silent party. So people wear headsets, and the only people that hear the music are the people wearing the headsets. So if the DJ is playing the music and there's 50 headsets on, the sound never travels out because it's only played in the headset.
If necessary, in addition to soundproofing, would you be willing to use that? So that way, you still have a DJ, but only the people with the headsets would hear the music. Would you be willing to do that?
That's a possibility. It's called a silent party.
And if they said you had to, if they said that's the only condition that they would allow you to keep a DJ, would you be willing to comply? Because I think, basically, they're saying that's where they're headed, and we want to make sure you're able to play music for your people there. People enjoy themselves, and at the same time, you don't have the neighbors complaining. That's all they're asking.
Well, don't please.
Sorry.
I think they're going to be asking a little more than that.
But
that's a biggie.
So I'm trying to address your...
Yes. Okay. I have no further questions.
Can I ask a question on the witness?
Yes.
I have a couple of questions. Statement. And, Counselor, I'm going to agree with you that this case is still open and we shouldn't debate it. But reading from the statement, it says, statements were taken from employees at Galveston in which they stated that IBN was under the influence of alcohol. So he was overserved. That's what I'm reading in that. What has you done to stop that from happening? Because this happened, a month or two ago? Has there been anything that's been done to stop this over-serving?
I've read the...
Exactly.
It's a very specific statement.
Oh, yes, we monitor the alcohol. Everyone has their tip cert. It's called a tip certification, their bartender certification. I make sure, and if I do hire anyone new, that everyone has that certification. And if it expired, they all have been recertified.
Can I ask a question? Are you still serving bottles?
We don't do bottle service.
You stopped doing that? I know you were doing that.
We don't do bottle service.
No longer.
Any longer.
Okay.
So, all right, that's all I have. Thank you.
Any other questions for the governing body? Mayor, I'm going to leave you. Meeting is back to you. I might just get an executive session.
All right, you've heard the testimony. Thank you, guys. We heard testimonies of...
We'll make a motion to go to executive session.
All right, at this time, I'll need a motion for executive session.
Motion.
Second.
Motion made by David, seconded by Carlos. We're going to go to executive session. We're going to go in the other room. I do not know how long it's going to take or if any final resolution is going to come up today. I probably would say to the residents and everybody involved, if you want to wait around, go ahead, but I don't know how long it's going to be. We got some things to think about. Something will come of it.
Regular session?
So moved.
Second. Motion made by Cecilia, seconded by Legati. All in favor?
Aye.
It's the recommendation of the ABC Board that there be a 30-day suspension commencing June 15th, a six-month probationary period commencing July 15th, no live music or DJ at any time, and the amending of current special condition number 2 regarding the security employment that will begin at 8 p.m., and they must be properly attired so that they are clearly identifiable. All conditions currently on the license will remain in effect. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
Second.
Motion made by David, seconded by Carl. Vitch, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to close the ABC hearing.
Second. Motion made by Shelke, seconded by Clemente. All in favor?
Aye.
Can I want to just say something. Can I say something?
Can you? You may not. No, yes.
I just want to say, you know, back in September of 2018, this is to Jessica, you said, this is not easy for you, this is not easy for me. I'm trying to run a business and I'm trying to be a good neighbor. I'm willing to do whatever you need me to do so that you're happy and I can keep running my business. Well, our residents aren't happy, so I'm not happy. And all the conditions that we put were so this wasn't going to happen again. And I don't believe that they were met. And I just want to say that, you know, these were things that you agreed to. And we still have, we're going to go through this every 6 months or a year. We need there to be changes, real changes, for your success and the residents' success. Thank you.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Okay, motion made by Shelby, seconded by David. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.